우리가 보통 알기로는 이제 마지막 때 이스라엘과 이란과의 전쟁이 일어날 거다 이렇게들 알고 있는데 목사님께서 쓰신 책을 보니까 From Iraq to Armageddon이라고 하는 그 책에서 그 이라크의 전쟁에 대해서 이야기를 하셨습니다. 그 얘기를 좀 해주시죠.
And to tell you the truth, I remember back in the 1980s saying, I don't want to ever teach about the end times. It's irrelevant. It's all false. Everyone's wrong. But then I began to get perplexed about it, and people began to ask us, and they began to say, well, if you're Jewish believers, you must have an eschatology. We didn't even have one. Well, I said, what? I didn't even know we had an eschatology. All we wanted to do was preach the gospel to Jewish people. We were just evangelists. But people said, well, tell us, what do you understand about the end times? And a funny thing happened. We began to see that there was tremendous confusion in every denomination across Christianity. Everything they taught about the end times was so contradictory. And so I remember that I just went back in the 1980s and I said, look, God, I challenged God. And I said, look, it can't be that contradictory in your Bible. I said, here's what I'm going to do. I went throughout the Bible, Old Testament and New Testament in Hebrew. I photographed every passage that I could find on the having to do with the end times. I put it in a stack on my desk and I said, now look, God, the answer is going to be in that pages. I'm going to keep reading that over and over again until it's got to make sense. And so I just began to do that over and over and over again. And finally, in about 5, 6, 7 years of study on just going over and over it, it all just began to fit into place for me. And I said, wow, this seems very kind of obvious now that I'm seeing it. My friend that I worked with back in the 1980s, we wrote the book Israel, the Church, in the Last Days together, Dan Juster. He had done a similar study, but in a different way. We got together after 5 years, and we compared notes, and we saw that we had seen everything 99% exactly the same way. So we wrote the book together, Israel, the Church in the Last Days, and then I wrote this other book about it. And so we have a series of teachings about the end times. Now, why is that? One more introduction. And that is that because all of the prophecies about the end times speak of a war coming out from all the nations, coming to attack Israel, and Yeshua coming back to Jerusalem. It's all focused right here. So obviously, the correct teaching about the end times has got to come out of here, has to have some sort of Israeli perspective, because this is where the events take place. If you don't see that, then it becomes disconnected. And that's what happens in most church teaching, that there is a disconnection between prophecies about the end times and any kind of real events. Because if you don't connect the people and the nation and the time and the geography, it just becomes floating events. I give a funny example, and I say that the central event of the end times is the second coming of Jesus. It's not that difficult to understand. 2,000 years ago, he was here on earth. He went to heaven. Pretty soon, he's going to come back from heaven here to earth. That's all you need to understand. The main prophecy, the central event, the number one, there's many events of the end times, but the most important central event of the end times is the second coming of Yeshua. He comes back from heaven to earth. And in a funny way, you can compare that to a plane that's traveling and lands in an airport. Jesus is the plane. Now, here's the question is, what's the airport? The airport is Israel. It's Jerusalem. Now, what happens is you have just the opposite for the Jewish people and the church. The Jewish people understand the importance of Israel, but they don't see Jesus. So what they have is an airport with no plane landing. Nobody comes back. Nobody's coming. There's all this war attacking Israel, and nobody knows why. That's what Jewish people see. Now, Christians who don't understand Israel, what do they have? They have a plane with nowhere to land. So the plane circles around and around. There's nowhere to go and goes away. And that's how a lot of Christians see the end time, that Jesus comes halfway back, never really comes down, circles around, goes back up and leaves. Nothing ever happens. So all we're saying is, you have the Christian worldview of Jesus coming from heaven with the Israelite worldview of the nations coming against Israel attack. You just put those two together, that as Jesus comes back is the time that the nations attack Israel. And the two caused events. Jesus comes back as the king of Israel, the king of the armies of the God of Israel, to defend the nation of Israel when all the enemies attack. And the reverse way. The enemy's attacks is being inspired by the devil to stop the second coming of Jesus. So as we come to close to the second coming of Jesus, that's what makes for the battle. The coming makes for the battle. The battle makes for the coming. The two just fit together. So what we basically have is a simple, holistic worldview. You take the scriptures from the beginning to end, and it comes to an obvious conclusion, history moving together, the church, Israel, the second coming, all these events coming together. And the scriptural pattern, when you see that, is basically, as far as I can see, 99% clear, basically very clear on it. Those, once you see that worldview, hey, all of our friends that see that, we disagree with less than even 1%. You disagree with a few points here and there, or timing places, but the general series of events are very obvious and very consistent in the scriptures. And so that's what we just want to say. See both the Old Testament prophecies about the attacks on Israel. See the New Covenant prophecies about the coming of Jesus. Just put them together and you have a very obvious holistic view of the end times, that most of the pieces fit together. And I'll give you one last thing that I've said, that the central event, again, of the end times, number one, is the second coming of Jesus. If that's not the most important event, you get out of sync. The most important event is not the rapture, it's not the resurrection, it's not Armageddon, it's not all these things. Jesus' second coming, that's the central pole. Now, in the Bible, I see there are many passages that speak about it, many, but there are two more than any others that are most clear. One is in the Israelite prophets and one is in the book of Revelation. You see it in the Hebrew prophets, is in Zechariah 14, which is very simple. All the nations of the world will come to attack Jerusalem, and then Jehovah will come and his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives. That's the second coming from looking from the ground view. And then in the book of Revelation, it's Revelation 19:11, and it says the heavens open, Yeshua comes down on a white horse, leading the armies of heaven to attack the forces of Antichrist on the earth. It just doesn't say where. It's obvious where it is. You just put those two together. Revelation 19:11 shows Yeshua coming back from the heaven viewpoint. Zechariah 14:1 shows him arriving here on the ground point. You just put the airplane and the airport together. Revelation 19 and Zechariah 14 together, and it will all fit together. Once you see that click, heaven and earth coming, those two connections, everything else, actually, to my mind, becomes pretty obvious. Of course, there's a few details one here that people can disagree on, but the general view of the end times is actually not that hard to understand.
목사님 쓰신 글 중에 예수님의 재림을 위한 조건의 우선순위라는 글이 있습니다. 지금 이스라엘의 여러 가지 상황들이 목사님이 말씀하셨던 그 주님 오심을 위한 우선순위 조건에 부합되는 그런 부분이 있습니까?
Of course, in the most simple way, every day that we pass, we're one day further away from the cross and one day closer to the second coming of Yeshua. So that's our general pattern. There's no doubt that when you look at the sweep of the prophecies about the end times, there's many things that have to just be in place for the prophecy to happen. Those things for most of the last 2,000 years were never in place. People in Israel weren't even here. So you can understand why people couldn't imagine Jesus coming back, because there weren't any people here. Now, but in our generation, almost all of the pieces of the puzzle that have to be in position for the second coming to place, they're all here. Now, they have to develop a little bit more, but they're all here. Israel is back in the land. Israel has taken Jerusalem back as the capital. Within the nation of Israel, there is a group of Jewish believers in Jesus who are sharing the gospel around the world. There are Christians around the world that love Israel and are praying for Israel, that see themselves grafted in. The gospel in our generation has come around the whole world and is now coming across Asia. So you obviously couldn't have had the end times until there was a sweep of faith coming across Asia. And now that's coming into place. There would have to be, according to the end times prophecy, a worldwide federation of governments, which never happened before, which is in place now. You would have to have some sort of philosophy or religion that would hate Jews and Christians. That's in place today. In other words, so many things. I can't think of a single piece of the puzzle that isn't available to us now. So does that mean it's going to happen tomorrow? Well, no, I think the pieces in the puzzle have to develop a little bit more. For instance, like in Israel today, we have Messianic Jews. We're here, we're in the land, but the Bible says that there will be 144,000 and there'll be a great revival here. So we have a little more to go, but the puzzle piece is there. The puzzle piece has to grow. Islamic extremism is growing. I think it's going to grow more. It's not at a place now where it could do that, but it's getting closer. The United Nations is there. It doesn't control the world, but it's getting more. And so all the different factors are in place. Another factor that's in place is a pending economic disaster, which it says clearly in the Bible has to take place. And when you look at the fact that the United States of America is $19 trillion in debt, we are that potentially that close to an economic disaster. So when I look at all of the different pieces of the end times prophecy, I can't think of a single piece of the puzzle that isn't in place right now. None of them are big enough yet, so I don't think it's going to happen in the next year or two. But they all have to grow. But they're all there. They're all there. So I would think we're coming into now. I think we're starting the generation of the end times because all of the pieces are in place. The pieces have to grow a little bit, but they're all there. And the fact that they're all in position has never happened in any time in history. That's an amazing thought. And it's also an amazing fulfillment of scriptures. It's a proof that the scriptures are true, because the scriptures said this would all happen 2,000-3,000 years ago. And for the past 2,000 years, Israel's been in exile. The prophecy didn't even see relevant in any imagination. You couldn't even imagine the prophecies taking place. Now they're all exactly in position. You think you wouldn't even have to be a believer to see that this is what's going to happen. It's just obvious in the mega trends of what's happening culturally. It's obviously going to happen. So it's both encouraging and a little can be a little scary, but we know the Bible says that we're going to move into some very, very difficult times, but we will come through the difficult times into a great victory at the end. But we do need to be ready. We're going to go through a difficult time, and there will be a happy ending, but the happy ending is after the difficult time.
제가 이번에 한국 이야기를 좀 하겠습니다. 지금 한국은 뭐 종교의 자유와 신앙의 자유가 있는 나라이기 때문에 120년 전에 기독교 신앙이 들어와서 지금 많은 크리스천들이 생겼지만 최근 들어서는 이 무슬림들도 많이 들어오고 이슬람 종교도 많이 지금 세력이 한국에서도 확장되고 있습니다. 그래서 한국에서는 그 요즘 들어서 이 무슬림들을 자주 볼 수 있게 되고요. 특히 한국 정부가 무슬림들이 먹게 되는 이 할랄 음식을 한국에서 만들어서 이 무슬림 국가에게 수출할 수 있도록 그런 그 정책을 편대든가, 또 최근 들어서 이제 이란의 어떤 핵 제재 이 핵 포기로 인한 경제 제재 완화 조치로 인해서 한국의 경제인들이 한국의 정부가 이란에 들어가서 이제 돈을 벌기도 하는 그런 그 이 정책을 많이 펼 것 같아요. 어떻습니까? 그 제가 보기에는 그동안 그 무슬림들이 들어오는 거에 대해서 너그럽게 대했던 유럽의 여러 나라들이 최근 들어서 이제 너무 이제 무슬림들이 많이 늘어나서 생기는 어려움을 겪듯이 한국도 머지않아 그런 문제에 직면하게 되지 않을까 이런 생각을 하게 되고요. 또 그동안 우리가 한국 정부가 이스라엘과 좋은 관계를 가졌다가 이제는 또 이란과 관계를 개선하면서 그런 분위기로 갈 때 어떤 크리스천들은 정부를 향해서 무슬림이 들어오는 거 또는 이 할랄 식품 이 공업 단지를 건설하는 것을 중단해라 이렇게 데모하고 시위하는 사람도 있고 또 그거에 대해서 기도하는 사람들도 있습니다. 목사님께서 이스라엘은 워낙 무슬림들이 많이 있고 또 유럽에 다니면서 그런 모습들을 많이 보셨기 때문에 지금 한국의 상황에서 한국의 상황을 보시고 해 주실 얘기가 있다면 어떤 얘기를 해 주시겠습니까?
Well, first I want to say that we have a great love for the Korean people, 한국, and particularly not just Israel as a nation, but also for us as the Messianic community feel very close to the Christian community in Korea. I myself started to go to Korea in, I think, 1990, maybe even 89, and came many times throughout the years. I love the nation of Korea, and we see a certain parallel with the nation of Korea being a small nation in a land bridge between larger nations, and find themselves historically in a little similar way to the Jewish people. So we feel a lot of connections with them. I think that's what's happening in Korean society and culture is fortunately or unfortunately happening in many nations around the world, and it's difficult. In Yeshua himself said that in the end times, it will become as the situation was in the time of Noah and in the time of Lot. That's quoting from, of course, Matthew 24 and from Luke 17 and so on. Now, you look at that, what was the prominent problem in the time of Noah? It seems to be violence. Amazingly enough, in the Hebrew scripture, when it says there was violence was all over the earth in the time of Noah, it happens to have the word Hamas there, but I think that's just a coincidence. But and then in the time of Sodom and Gomorrah, of course, what did you see? There were many sins, but the most prominent was sexual perversion. And we see that going around the world today, mostly coming out of the Islamic extremism, a type of violence that we've almost never seen before. An evilness to violence, cutting people's heads off with joy, having little children murder adults. I don't know that we've ever seen something like that before. And on the other hand, coming out of much of the Western world, there is a type of sexual perversion that is so grotesque that I think it may have even been worse than it was in Sodom and Gomorrah. So both of those two things were already prophesied about by Yeshua himself and his disciples, and we see that happening. So we really should be expecting that. And according to the prophecies, it's likely to get even worse, because it's not yet the way it was in Sodom and Gomorrah and the way it was in the time of Noah. It should be more. Now, there's one other classic example, if you go all the way back to the Torah of Moses, and that was the judgment in Egypt. The judgment in Egypt, the Exodus in Egypt, is also a model of the end times, just as Noah and Lot and Egypt. The time of a huge judgment and then a people being rescued and saved out, that is true both of Noah's time and Lot's time and of Egypt. In Egypt, what did we see? It was mostly a type of satanic occult. You had people worshiping snakes. You had the head of the government. You can see pictures in the pyramids, the head of the government wearing snakes on their heads and so on. So you have the example of in Egypt of an extreme occultism, the example of Sodom of extreme sexual perversion, and the example of Noah of extreme violence. Do we see that happening today? Yes. Is it likely to get worse? Yes. Will there be a great victory at the end? Yes. Are we going to have to go through difficult times to get to that victory? Yes. The scriptural pattern is clear in every single example, in every generation, whether it's Noah, whether it's Lot, whether it's Pharaoh, whether it's Esther, whether it's every generation, it's the same spiritual pattern, but it will all come to a head. We will see, yes, the worst kind of violence, the worst kind of sexual perversion, and the worst kind of satanic occultism than we've ever seen. It will be perhaps the most difficult time, likely to be, the most difficult time for believers to have to go through. But we will come out the other end in the greatest victory, the greatest revival. We don't want to look at this as a bad time, because at the same time that the evil arise, the Bible says that grace is even more. During that same time of those three great evils, of the occult violence and sexual perversion, the Bible also says, God said, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And it speaks of the greatest revival in history. Jesus said the great harvest of souls happens in the end times. So yes, while this evil is happening, there will also be a revival going on. Now, is that true? Can you have revival while there's also persecution? Of course you can. And so that's what will happen. There will be extreme difficulties, but there will also be great advancement for the kingdom of God. And we need to be strong to go through all this so that we can reach the goal of a victorious second coming. I want people to be victorious through the end times, through the tribulations, and get to the great victory of Jesus. I'm not teaching something negative. I'm saying if we understand what the evil is that's about to happen, we can be strengthened in faith and have victory and grace during the tribulation. And then we can see the coming of the kingdom of God and be part of being the great revival and the fullness of Israel and the church and all the glorious things God wants to do. We can be part of it, but we need to know it. We need to get equipped in faith. We need to be ready to pray and prophesy and stand and be faithful and obedient and holy and let God do his glorious work through us. Now, one other thing. Now, I say this very superficially, only in love as I look to it, but I watched over the years the Korean church grow and grow with great love, and I actually had the opportunity to speak in many of the largest churches in Korea and be at some of the largest conferences there, really some of the largest churches even in downtown Seoul. I had the privilege of being there and speaking at them. But it seemed to me, as I look at it from the side, that because of the huge growth that there was there, God blessed the nation. And when God blessed the nation, there was a certain prosperity that came. And exactly what happened in the history of Israel, sometimes when that blessing comes, the blessing becomes a temptation. And it seemed like a lot of the younger generation wanted the blessings of God more than they wanted God. And they turned to wanting more disco and Gangnam Style and all that kind of garbage. And what I understand what happens is a revival breaks out always in the midst of persecution. Then God blesses the nation, and therefore you get increased prosperity, blessing, communication tools, economic tools. And then comes another challenge. The nation has to see itself transition to a missionary, world-changing nation. Because when you have those tools, you can't just stay still with them. You either have to use them to further the kingdom or you become pleasure-seeking. And that's been true of every nation of the world. And I think that's been a challenge for the Korean church now is going to have to fight to get back to that kind of holiness and humility. And what God wants us to do is to maintain a heart as if you have nothing and that you're poor and that you're being persecuted while he's blessing us with all the outward blessings so we can use them for the kingdom. But we have to maintain ourselves pure while he's blessing us. And that's a very difficult thing to do. We pray that there's going to be another wave of fire coming through the Korean church and particularly to the young people.
우리 브리드 TV 시청자들은 이스라엘 위해서 기도하는 분들이 많이 보셔요. 우리 브리드 TV 시청자들에게 우리 아시로 목사님께서 인사 한마디 해주시고 지금 이 상황에서 이스라엘 위해서 기도할 때 이런 부분을 좀 집중적으로 기도해 주십시오. 기도 제목을 얘기해 주시면서 오늘 이야기를 또 마치도록 하겠습니다.
Well, we just want to say to all of our dear friends in Korea that 감사합니다. We want to say thank you. I want to say thank you for the 예수님 사랑, that the love of Jesus that is with you. And I have personally received so much from you. And just a little tiny bit that I want to give back and say, we love you so much. And we really believe that there's a partnership, the partnership in our generation between Korea and all of East Asia with Israel is very significant. For one thing, the Israeli people don't have the bad associations with Christianity from the Far East as they do from European. And was European Christianity has an association with the Jewish people of the Holocaust and the Middle Ages and so on of persecution. Whereas when they look to East Asian Christians, it's all positive. And Jewish people love East Asia. They love Indians and Chinese and Koreans and Japanese. They love in Thailand, of course. They love the Asian people. So it's a very special opportunity. Secondly, we so much need your prayers. The community of believers here in Israel is very small. We're very weak in the natural, and the amount and quality and intensity of the prayers that come out of our dear friends from East Asia is allowing us to survive here. And we're so thankful, and we just ask you to keep praying with us. And we want to be partners with you, seeing ourselves as equal partners, blessing one another, not a one-way street, but being here to bless one another, to love one another, and give to one another. So I just want to say to you and to all of our dear friends on the television here and around the world and in South Korea and in East Asia, we just want to say thank you so much. We appreciate you, and we're happy to be in partnership with you. And please keep praying for you, for us. We love you, and the best is yet to come as we look to more and more partnership as we come together in this beautiful harmony. When Israel, the people of Israel, see the harmony that there is in the Asians and the Europeans and the Africans and the Arabs with the Jewish people, that we all love one another and respect one another, it's going to be such a beautiful witness that our people will be part of receiving the faith. And we see ourselves as partners together with you. Again, thank you so much. 감사합니다.
감사합니다. 아, 오늘 이렇게 귀한 시간 내주시고 아주 중요한 이야기를 많이 해주셔서 감사합니다. 다음에 또 뵙도록 하고요. 다음에 더 깊은 이야기들을 또 나누도록 하겠습니다. 고맙습니다. 감사합니다. Thank you very much.